Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm Nick Delgado with the Guam Daily Post, bringing you your new digital election show, The Race Is On. We are coming to you via Zoom during pandemic condition of readiness one. Tonight, we speak with your candidates in the running to be in the 36th Guam legislature. And let's get to tonight's group. Candidate number one, we have newcomer Joseph J.I. Cruz. Candidate number two, also a newcomer, Dominic Hernandez. And our next candidate, candidate number three, a newcomer as well, John Ananich. Off of it, everyone. Now to show you how this is all going to go, we bring you to the starting line.
First, our team of journalists are speaking with voters across the island. Voters will ask a question, then candidates, you get 60 seconds to answer the question. When the clock runs out, time's up. Give the next candidate a shot, or let's get on to the next question. Ready, set, let's race.
And now to our first reporter out in the field, Oya Nirikle, who's in Jigo, with your first question and our first voter. Oya?
Thanks, Nick. I'm here with Jan Fontabueno of the village of Jigo, and he has a question.
Yeah, my question is, what are you going to do about the homeless population here in Guam? Because there's a lot of people out on the streets begging right there, right in front of Micronesia Mall. So, I mean, it looks bad on Guam. We're supposed to be a people that care about each other. But then what about the people that need help?
Great question. Back to you, Nick.
All right. Thanks, Oya, for that question and for that voter's question. First, we'll start with Mr. Cruz, your response.
I would think that, thank you, Nick. I think that's a very good question. And thank you to the voter that asked that question. I see homelessness as potentially being a part or being a socioeconomic issue. There are other issues that are related to homelessness, but that is something that government officials really need to truly understand. Understand what those socioeconomic issues are, what those potential issues are, some of them behavioral, there are many other issues related to that. But I think the biggest issue to understand the problem of homelessness is getting out into the homeless population and understand what the dynamic is, what's going on, and then figure out from within the resources within government how to best deal with those socioeconomic issues. Because I truly believe, Nick, that by merely just putting them in a homeless shelter doesn't necessarily address the issue of homelessness. So goes the saying, you can feed a man a fish for a day and feed him for that day, but if you teach him how to fish, you feed him for right. The rest of his life.
All right. So I would think that's your time.
The best thing
Thank
to
you.
Do is to understand that dynamic and to be able to figure out what resources are available based on knowing what that is. And as right. an elected official...
That's your time, Mr. Cruz. Thanks for your response. Mr. Hernandez, your response?
Asking the question. First, with homelessness, yes, I do agree that just putting them in a shelter isn't just enough. We do need to understand why they became homeless, whether it's because mental issue, drug issues, whatever the case may be, we have to look into the source of the problem and find a way to help them. Definitely with going into the shelter as well, I think we should also include the Department of Labor to help them find jobs so that they can stabilize themselves and get back on their feet as best as they can as soon as possible. And as well seek any counseling that they might need and find the resources available through the government to be able to fund these resources so that they can get the help they need to end the homelessness and hopefully reduce the amount of people that are going homeless.
Okay. Thank you for your response. Next, Mr. Ananich.
Yes, you know, I'd have to agree with both J.I. and Dominic there is the homeless issue is basically finding out how they got there to begin with. You know, because there are a lot of different issues as to why people are homeless. So I think we need to attack the individual and find out, you know, why they're there. But homeless is not only people that don't have shelter, because there's even homeless that I would consider who are in substandard living. And then those people as well would need to be, provided an opportunity to move up in how they're living. So homeless is a huge issue. It's not only... people not having shelter, but people also in substandard shelters. And we need to look at the whole reason, and first and foremost, is definitely what they is how did they become homeless, and attack those issues as well. Thank you, Nick.
All right, candidates, thank you all so much for your response to that first question. Let's take it out now to our John O'Connor and Haganya with our next voter and their question. John?
Hey, Nick. I'm here with Raphael. Raphael, what is your question?
Yes, I'd like to ask all the candidates out there, what are you going to do to address the issue of affordability of housing here in Guam for all the local residents?
Okay, Nick. Okay, Nick, back to you.
Thanks, John. Well, candidates, now time to take a second lap. And remember, 60 seconds, please, for your response for that question. And for this one, we'll start with Mr. Hernandez. Your response?
Thank you, Nick, and thank you to the person asking the question. As far as being able to afford housing, I think part of the issue we have to look at is definitely with the BAH as being issued through the military, because most of the rental places I know of, they tend to base it upon the BAH. So maybe that's something we can negotiate with the military and try to figure out a way to either lower it and or maybe make it to where it's like the states, where in the states you get BAH and you decide what you do with it, how much you want to spend for rent and so forth. That way it can hopefully alleviate some of the rental issues with costs.
Next, Mr. Ananich. Next, we have Mr. Ananich.
Yes, hi, can you hear me, Nick?
Yes.
Okay, yes, you know, I believe that there's already some resources out there like HUD, you know, that we can actually look at and start working with HUD and getting that assistance out to our people. I know that there's programs that are already in place. I think what we need to do is go ahead and take a look at these programs and, you know, make more use of it and allow these programs to be more acceptable to the people that need affordable housing. Because I believe that there's already programs and they're not being maximized. So what we need to do is re-educate the public on that and put HUD to work for the people and get that message out, Nick. Thank you.
All right. Thank you for that response. Mr. Cruz?
Thank you. And I appreciate that question from the voter. I think that the way to address the issue of affordable housing ties directly back to the economy. I think that if we can get the economy to continue to boom, to continue to grow, and to continue to move our economic prosperity forward, we can make homes more affordable. But I would also say that I think it's finding that happy balance between growing our economy and making or finding resources to make homes more affordable, so that people in the working class or those citizens that need more help in that regard to make housing more affordable. So I think it's tied back to the economy and making homes more affordable for everybody on the island. Thank you, Nick.
All right, candidates, thank you so much for your responses and for answering the voters' questions. Well, viewers, you know what time it is. It's time for a quick pit stop. But first, we wanted to show our viewers a different side of the candidates, one you'll likely only catch right here on The Race Is On.
The halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we fight our country's battles in the air, on land and sea. First to fight for right and freedom, and to keep our honor clean. We are proud to claim the title of United States Marines. Our flags unfurl to every breeze, from dawn to setting sun. We have fought in every time and place where we could take a gun. In the snows of far off northern lands and in sunny tropic scenes, you will find us always on the job, the United States Marines. Here's to health to you and to our Corps, which we are proud to serve. In many a strife we fought for life and never lost our nerve. If the army and the navy ever look on heaven's seas, they will find the streets are guarded by United States Marines. Hurrah!
Welcome back. Now we are at the turning point to take us to the final round. The candidate will get to respond to questions put together by your news team. It's part of the show where the candidates are under pressure to get their responses out there. And again, 1 minute each, please. We'll start, of course, with our first question over to Mr. Ananich. If elected, what will be your first action to improve the government of Guam's accountability in the spending of public funds?
Oh, definitely. The first action actually be to have oversight hearings on with all the department heads. I think there was far too few of that. I think what we need to do in order to keep in the know is have more oversight hearings and bring these department heads, accountable and bring them in and find out what's going on with the government. Because the only way we're going to know how to change anything or make anything better is to know what's going on. So I think the lack of oversight hearings is detrimental to where we are today. So that's the first thing I would do is have a mandate every quarter that we have oversight hearings with our respective agency leaders. Thank you, Nate.
Thank you, Mr. Cruz.
I think that that is probably the single most important way to maintain accountability of public funds is to truly have a mechanism of being able to oversight that. And having that type of mechanism will allow elected leaders, will allow senators to be able to understand truly how the people's money are being spent. So I would say that oversight hearings are very important. I think that a mechanism in place so that the respective government agencies are automatically reporting back to the legislature to let the respective committees and the respective chairpersons understand what's going on with regards to the use of that particular money. So I think that kind of fiscal accountability is important so that a mechanism for them to be able to report as well as oversight is important. Thank you, Nick.
All right. Thank you for your response. Mr. Hernandez, your response?
Thank you, Nick. I agree with both of them. Definitely, we have to do some government accountability and see what's going on, especially within the government, where our money's being spent, and be transparent to the public because the public wants to know. It is rough times, and financially speaking, we're all hurting in some sort of way. So being transparent, straightforward, and holding people accountable is one of the first actions I would take as well.
All right, candidates, thanks for your responses to the first question. The second question, we'll begin with Mr. Cruz for this one. Should Gov Guam front the funding for the Trump-ordered unemployment benefits?
I think that, thank you for that question, Nick, and I think that that is something that we need to take a look at. Should they front the upfront? Should they front it? That would be something that would be dependent on the amount of fiscal resources available. If that is not possible, then how could we make use of that? And I go back to in my time as the chief of police, the only way I could make use of one particular fund is if I fronted it on the front end to be able to get that reimbursed. And it almost appears that that's the mechanism that's in place now. So as far as being able to front it, I think that there may be some challenges. So I would say that that may be something that may be a little bit difficult for the government of Guam to be able to do in order to take advantage of that federal funding.
Mr. Hernandez?
Thank you, Nick. I would definitely say yes, we should, just because of the fact of where we are financially. With P-Corps 1 in place right now, with a lot of businesses shut down, I mean, I understand the risk factors of the fact that, you know, if we front this, who knows how long it'll take for the money to come back and the difficulties and challenges just to be able to front it. But on the same note, with the amount of people that are now going back on unemployment and or the additional people being added to unemployment due to businesses being permanently shut down, I do recommend it is something we should definitely take a look into and probably consider doing.
All right, thank you. And Mr. Ananich.
You know, Nick, thank you for the question. I say absolutely we should fund it. You know, there's $117 million in CARES Act fees that that are earmarked right now. But I think that the most important thing is putting money into the people's hands so that they can, you know, just buy the basic necessities to survive. So I think we absolutely should fund it. People need to eat. People need to pay their rent. And I think that the monies that are already there, the $117 million that's earmarked, are not appropriated with the people's best health at mind. So absolutely, Nick, we need to get that money into these people's hands, and people need to be fed and to feed their families, and they need to pay for their rent. So absolutely, we need to fund that 100%, and we need to figure out how to do it. Because at the end of the day, we can appropriate funds elsewhere, but if people are starving, then people are going to, you know, it's definitely going to be a lot worse to have people starving, people thrown out of their house, because we feel that the money needs to be appropriated somewhere else. So absolutely 100%, let's fund it, and let's get money into the people's hands so they can feed their families. Thank you. Thank you.
Next question, and we will start with Mr. Hernandez for this one. Do you think Gov Guam should continue to fund charter schools, or do you feel charter schools take money from needed resources in public classrooms?
I believe that in general with education, it's important all around, regardless of what kind of school it is, because education at the end of the day is only going to help people in the longer run. So I believe that we should still do funding for it. Should we scale back? That's possibly something we can look into, just depending on the situation, of course, of where we stand financially. But nonetheless, if it deals with education, I'm all for funding it.
Okay. Mr. Cruz.
I will always say that the priorities of the government should always be public safety, public health, and public education. So when it comes to public education, absolutely, Nick, I think that the government of Guam needs to figure out how to continue to fund charter schools, because the bottom line is we need to get our children educated. And if we focus on that, on education, on health, on safety, then I think we're taking care of that which the people of Guam are most concerned about. So absolutely, I think that the government of Guam needs to consider that, and we need to look at continuing to fund charter schools, because yet it takes pressure and alleviates resources off of the Guam Department of Education, and it allows our children to get that education that they need. So 100%, absolutely, I think they should fund that, Nick. Thank you.
Yes, Nick, thanks for that question. And I have to agree with both Dominic and J.I. Cruz there. Absolutely, we have to fund education. I mean, you know, of course, the three main parts of government, you know, the education is one of them. So that's our job. So if, you know, if elected and, you know, if I have the opportunity to serve the people, then of course, education is going to be in the forefront. So 100%, I agree with them. You know, any school, especially charter school, or anywhere we send our kids to get educated, you know, the government should fund, and we should invest in our children. They're the future, and I think that every dollar spent on them is a dollar well invested. Thank you, Nick.
All right, guys. Thank you all so much for your responses. One more question this round, and we'll start with you again, Mr. Ananich. What one action will you take to encourage able-bodied adults to wean themselves off public assistance and rejoin the workforce?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that question, Nick?
Yeah. What one action will you take to encourage able-bodied adults to wean themselves off public assistance and join the workforce?
You know, I believe that that's already in place, Nick. We have the welfare, and we have welfare in Section 8. What I would do is I would actually enforce it, because I believe that there's a time frame on that, which is a 2-year period. And these people need to take care of themselves. But, you know, GCC has these apprentice programs for skilled workers. And I think what we can do is we can actually use some of that funding that we're using to give them on welfare, and put that towards GCC and some trade school, and allow them to learn a trade. So that way, after 2 years, they come out with some sort of skill that they can use and go out into the workforce and become independent. So what I would do is I'd take a look at that money that we're giving them on welfare and put a little bit of that into a trade academy that they go through, so that when they come out with a skill and they can get a job and actually help themselves and be independent. Thank you for question.
Thank you for your response. And for our next candidate will be Mr. Cruz.
Thank you, Nick. And I think that the one thing that I would do should I be elected to be able to wean those who are on public assistance off of that and into the workforce is to provide them opportunity. And what I mean by that is to be able to, for those that are on public assistance, to give them that skill, allow them to get that education, allow them to get that training so that they can have a skill that they can use in that workforce. Again, I go back to that saying of if you teach a person to fish, you feed them for the day. So I always go back to that. By providing those who are on public assistance with that kind of opportunity, by getting them that kind of education and training via a trades academy, like Mr. Ananich had mentioned, I think that provides that opportunity and that ability to be able to teach them to fish so that they can feed themselves for the rest of their lives. Thank you, Nick.
Thank you. Mr. Hernandez, your response?
Thank you, Nick. I do agree with both candidates. Getting the proper education and getting people into technical school so they can learn a trade or skill is one of the best ways to help them out, especially in getting out of poverty situations and to be able to earn proper income to be able to take care of their families. And not only that, but they could take this skill and trade and possibly use it somewhere else, maybe overseas, US, wherever it may be, to be able to earn more income and better income so that they can provide for their families. So I completely 100% agree with both of them on saying that. And I agree with what J.I. Cruz said about how we can teach a man to fish so that he can feed himself for the rest of their life versus just giving him a fish so he eats for a day.
All right, candidates. Well, thank you all so much for your responses. We are getting ready to sprint to the finish. Your candidates will get one more shot to tell the voters out there why vote for them when we return. This is The Race Is On.
I'm gonna make a change for once in my life. It's gonna feel real good. It's gonna make a difference. Gonna make it right. As I turned up the collar on my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind. I see the kids in the streets, wanting enough to eat. Who am I to be blind, pretending not to see their needs? A summer's disregard, a broken bottle top, in one man's soul. They follow each other on the wind, you know, 'cause they got nowhere to go. That's why I want you to know. Starting with the man in the mirror, and I'm asking him to change his ways. And no message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, and take a look at yourself and then make a change. Na 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 na.
Welcome back. Well, now that we took a quick break, candidates, it's your time to tell the voters out there why vote for you. You get 1 minute again to give your responses, and we'll start with Mr. Cruz.
Thank you, Nick. And Hafade Guam, and thank you very much for having me on the show. Over the last 35 years, ladies and gentlemen, I've spent my career, whether serving in the military, serving in the Guam Police Department, serving in the military and then going back into the police department, it's always been about service to the people. Whether it's service to our nation, service to our people here on Guam, service to our nation and our people, serving in the Guard, and then back again, serving in the people as your chief of police for the Guam Police Department. I'm looking to take the last 35 years into the Guam legislature, taking all that education and that experience and taking it to the next level to do what I can do to help the people of Guam. And for me, that's the reason why I'm running for office. I humbly ask for your vote this upcoming election, on the primary election, as well as in the general election. And again, in these very challenging times, you need good leadership at the table. You need hardworking, honest leaders at the table. I bring to the table 35 years of experience. I bring education, and I bring a passion to serve the people of Guam. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cruz, for your response. Mr. Hernandez.
Thank you, Nick, and half a day, Guam. As most of you may know, if you go to my Facebook page, my main talk is that I'm standing up for the voices being ignored. Too long has many of our voices been ignored, or too many promises have been broken. I'm not here to make any promises. I'm simply going to state the fact that I'm going to work my hardest to ensure that I help everybody for the common good of all people. We can sit here and debate all day about what is right or what is wrong, but what is the right thing to do is to help everybody within the best interest that we can for everybody. And that's why I'm running, to help as many people as possible and to ensure that we have proper government accountability, transparency, and as well that many voices will not be ignored as it has been for the past many years, especially throughout many elections. Thank you, Nick.
Thank you. Mr. Ananich?
Yes, hi, Nick. First of all, I'd like to say thank you, Nick. Thank you to you and your crew, and thanks for the opportunity. And half a day, Guam. Well, I'm running because I'm frustrated, and I know you are. I know you've seen some of my campaign ads already out there saying enough's enough. And basically, that's how I feel. It's time. It's time, Guam. It's time we take our streets and our neighborhood back from the predators and the criminals. It's time we tell the criminal that we will not be scared and we will not shelter from you. It's time we bring our community back up, stand up, and let's fight back. You know, we need to bring it back to a time where criminals feared the community, not the community scared of the criminals. Enough's enough. I am standing and I am running for a safer Guam, and I'm running a public safety platform. Visit my platform at johnananich.com to see everything about it. You can see it in its entirety. But please, I am not going to humbly ask for your vote, because these aren't humble times. These are times for aggressive leadership. These are times that we need people to stand up and make decisive decisions. So I am confidently asking for you to vote for me. I'm number 8 on the Democratic side of the ballot. God bless you, Guam. Be safe, wash your hands, and stay healthy. Thank you very much.
All right, Mr. Ananich, Mr. Cruz, Mr. Hernandez, thank you all so much for your time. And I hope you guys are all staying safe as well during these, back in this P-Corps 1 conditions. So again, thank you again for coming on and joining us on The Race Is On. And thank you so much again for your responses. Just a quick note, incumbent and current Vice Speaker of the Legislature, Talina Nelson, was scheduled to join us for tonight's show, but unfortunately she could not make it. But with that, thanks so much for joining us for another round of the Guam Daily Post digital election show, The Race Is On. You can always catch up with our show each night on the Guam Daily Post Facebook page, YouTube, or IGTV to hear from more of our candidates. And you can also pick up a copy of the Guam Daily Post to find out all you need to know before hitting the polls on August 29th. Stay safe, everyone. Thanks so much for watching. This is The Race Is On.